I'm back with another video on scripting. There are many useful things I could not cover in the last one, so I'll go over more specific segments in additional videos. But in this one, I will tell you about a few small nuances that were left out, but could be very useful. Let's start by examining script permissions in more detail. When you add a script, owner policy and the don't require permissions properties are set automatically. The owner is simply the user who added the script. But the execution is not limited to that user only. So if I log in as another user with another administrator account, I can still run it. However, the execution will be prevented for users who do not have full user rights. A read-only account cannot execute this script, even though it only reads information. But we can change this by setting the don't require permissions property to yes, and now it can be executed by anyone. Even the read-only users who cannot edit the source. This allows for a very neat way to give your non-admin users very specific abilities, if you will. But you cannot control which users will be able to run which scripts, as it is a simple on-off switch for everyone. What you can control is the policy. But for most people and most scripts, it is not necessary to alter it from the default. Theoretically, if you wrote a very versatile script that could end up executing almost any command, then you could limit the script's capabilities with the policy, but that is not usually the case. Another situation where I could imagine this property being used is when you have copied a script that you want to run for some reason, but you don't understand it. Then you could disable certain privileges like the ability to change the password and access sensitive information, for example. That is the sort of stuff that you can do with the policy. Let's move on to some code quirks. First up, I should mention that you can comment out lines using the hashtag symbol, so they don't get executed when debugging, for example. And of course, you can add informational comments. Another quick thing I should mention is that you can split lines without breaking the execution. Just go to one of the spaces and type a backslash followed by enter. You can do it as many times as necessary, and it can help you tidy things up when you are exceeding the workable width of your terminal. Now, whenever you press enter, you are actually typing an invisible symbol, sometimes called an end of line sequence or just a new line character. Historically, there have been differences between these characters in different operating systems, and Windows has taken a double character approach. The same two-character sequence is being used in router scripts. This could potentially have an implication when copying and pasting lines of code between different environments or using a script to access information from somewhere else. If we create a string and we want to include a new line, we could just press enter, but that breaks up the line in our script. So alternatively, we can also use backslash n. Those two characters will get interpreted as a new line. Now, the put command is displaying these with a little tab added, but both new lines are the same. The backslash in strings is used to escape the typical use of characters. In this case, it turns the letter N into a new line. But there are several other such cases, and they are known as escape sequences. So, for example, you can use it to include a double quote inside of a string, preventing that symbol from ending the string. Similarly, you can include the backslash itself into a string, and so on. You can even include specific hex values of symbols, so 4D and 54 can become MT. Moving on, it is possible to concatenate or combine strings. All you have to do is place a simple dot between them. Alternatively, you can also combine some text with a variable. If one of those variables is of a different kind, like a number or a boolean, it will still work, as long as the output is text. The last thing that I would like to touch on is command substitution. I already showed you in the last video that you can execute multiple operations in brackets and that the dollar sign, which is used to call variables, can also be used before brackets to perform operations inside of a string. But what you might not realize is that we also have the square brackets, which can be used to substitute commands. Here's what it looks like. The first string will get its value assigned from the output of the identity print command, but the second string will have the get command called inside it. So now if we run the script, we can see that the output is a simple identity print followed by a sentence containing a specific MAC address that was inserted using the command substitution. Alright, that is enough information for this video. If you are interested in scripting, stay tuned as there are a couple more videos coming soon.